This is Dr. Cynthia First from the University of Utah. Today we're going to be talking about broadband antennas. Broadband antennas are particularly interesting because we have many applications today where multiple bands are needed. The example we'll be talking about for the next few minutes is this planar inverted F antenna. The PIFA is made from a piece of copper, hence planar, and it's bent like this and fed with this simple feed system. If you look closely, here's the F part of the planar inverted F. When we're considering the bandwidth of an antenna, we first look at all possible parameters of interest. For example, the return loss, the VSWR, the radiation pattern, gain, directivity, polarization, etc. We find all the frequency bands where all of the parameters meet our specifications, and then that defines the bandwidth of the antenna. So for this example of the PIFA antenna, we have a lower frequency and an upper frequency, and the bandwidth is defined as the upper frequency minus the lower frequency. Sometimes we define our bandwidth as the fractional bandwidth. Then we say it's the upper frequency minus the lower frequency divided by the center frequency. Occasionally, we even define this as percent. So it's upper minus lower divided by center times 100, and we give that as a percent. The ratio bandwidth is the upper divided by the lower. And we can define the bandwidth several different ways. For example, if we have an application where we need to use all the frequencies at the same time, we would be defining an instantaneous bandwidth. Applications where that might show up is when we have a pulse, such as for a pulsed radar system. That's different than this application here because you can see that we don't necessarily need DCS and ISM at the same time. In this case, we have multiple bands that we need, and the antenna is designed so it can use all of the bands at the same time. On the other hand, if we had chosen a return loss of minus 15 decibels, our antenna would be only functional in two individual multiple bands. Sometimes we have an antenna that we can tune over a variety of frequencies, and then we consider that a tunable antenna, and we define the bandwidth as its tunable bandwidth. What is a broadband antenna? If an antenna has a ratio bandwidth greater than 2, that's an octave of bandwidth, we would say that antenna is typically broadband. Other names that we use are wideband or ultra-wideband, and those may be synonymous with broadband, although sometimes they are names for specific communication standards. A frequency-independent antenna is the ultimate broadband antenna because it behaves the same for all frequencies. When we're designing a broadband antenna, there are three basic concepts that we keep in mind. One is that we want to be able to use multiple or many resonant lengths. For example, if we have a single dipole antenna, we know that that antenna is resonant at lambda by 2. The physical length of the antenna is going to be very narrow band because there is only one wavelength that is going to have lambda by 2 for that physical length. If instead we used a bow tie antenna, that we'll be looking at shortly, there are actually multiple resonant lengths in here. There's your dipole resonant length, as well as some additional resonances along the sides. Then we'll be talking about self-complementary structures and the fact that thick metal antennas are broader band than thin. So for example, if I used a cylindrical dipole, it's going to have a broader bandwidth than a thin dipole. Self-complementary structures are when the shape and its blank space are equal. So consider this antenna here, for example, where the black antenna and the blue antenna can be interwoven so that the antenna and its blank space are equal. That means that this antenna could be self-complementary. Now let's first look at a bow tie antenna. It's the simplest type of broadband antenna. If we had had a simple dipole, filling just this space, for example, here is the bandwidth that would have been attained. Let's say that we need an S11 of minus 10 decibels. Here's the bandwidth that we could have had for the dipole antenna. But for the bow tie antenna, we have additional resonant lengths, and so here's the bandwidth for the bow tie antenna, which is broader than the bandwidth for the simple dipole antenna. There are several other types of bow tie antennas. You can see this, for example, is a printed bow tie where just the outside shape is printed. You can have both a solid and a form bow tie, as shown here. Here is a fractal bow tie or a spiral bow tie. Here's a bow tie that handles polarizations in both horizontal and vertical directions. Here's a folded bow tie antenna. The cone antenna is another type of broadband antenna. Here's a basic cone antenna, shown right here, but this particular one has a disc on the top, so that is a disc cone antenna. Here is a cone or horn antenna and a parabolic antenna as well. Here is a conical dipole antenna. You can kind of see the cone shape here. It's produced just from wires. It's often used for electromagnetic compatibility measurements. Down here on the bottom, we can see a simple cone antenna built from putting up several posts, running a wire between them, and then running several other wires up from a single feed point on the ground. Another type of broadband antenna is a horn antenna. These horns have a flange in the center that increases their bandwidth. You can see this one is particularly broadband, going from 100 megahertz to 1 gigahertz. The horn shown here on the left goes from 18 to 40 gigahertz. Helical antennas are another type of broadband antenna. This one right here uses the metal part of the helix as the antenna, and this one uses the empty part or the non-metallic part right there as the helix. Many types of cell phone antennas are helical. Here you can see helical antennas that are being used for radio communication. Notice this grid right here, that acts as the ground plane for the antenna, and here is a spiral helical antenna. This is a 3D helical antenna. In fact, this one right here you can see is just printed in 3D. The log periodic is another type of broadband antenna. In the log periodic, we have several different effectively dipole antennas. Here's the one for the lowest frequency, and here's the one for the highest frequency. These antennas are completely fed. This metallic arm right here feeds all of the bottom parts of the dipole, and then this arm right here feeds the top parts of the dipole. So you can have a log periodic antenna in many shapes, including this one that's round or spiral. The Yagi-Uda is often considered similar to the log periodic antenna, but it has one very significant difference. Only one element of the Yagi-Uda antenna is fed. The others act as passive director antennas. Spiral antennas are also broadband designs. This one right here you can see is thinner in the center part of the spiral, spiraling out to being thicker and thicker and thicker, and then again thin on the end. This is a different type of spiral. It's an Archimedes spiral, where all of the arms are the same thickness, but still it spirals around like so. Here is a conical spiral, here's a planar printed spiral, and here's a spiral antenna that we use for medical implants. So there are several different types of broadband antennas. In class, we're going to spend some time with some technical papers that talk about different types of broadband antennas. What we're going to be looking for in those papers are the different parameters and the types of design methods that are used to design broadband antennas. So I look forward to talking with you further in class. Thank you very much for listening.